Welcome to the Industry Angel Podcast. We hear from the best business minds across the globe. Entrepreneurs, social influencers, marketing mavens, and sales rock stars. We've got them all. Here comes your weekly dose of inspiration with your host, Ian Farrer.
Welcome to episode 95 of the Industry Angel. Summer's still in full swing here in the UK. Let's hope it continues. Shame about us being knocked out of the World Cup this week, though. It's been great to see business get behind the campaign, allowing staff the time off, making provision to watch it somehow. So if that was you and your business, well done. Tickets and details of the 100th episode can now be found on industryangel.com right now. It's going to be a live event here in South Shields, with the Customs House Director, Ray Spencer, MBE. It'll be on Tuesday, August 14th, from about 5:30. So we'll do the usual bit. We'll have beer and pizza and lots of fun. So industryangel.com on the homepage, and it'll take you to Eventbrite. So grab your tickets. Okay, then, let's get this show on the road. Today, we have the founder of SEO agency, Pearl Lemon. Welcome to the Industry Angel, Deepak Shukla.
Ian, thank you so much. I'm excited to be here, dude. And we've already had a laugh off air, so I'm even more excited for on, buddy.
Well, we have. And I tell you what I won't do, though. I won't tell our listeners what microphone you're using and how much was it, all right? Because the audio sounds perfect. Even if it was £5, oh my God, I've just said it.
Oh, Jesus anyway. Christ. he was a very nice Pakistani friend of mine. He did us well. It has been my seventh pair I burnt through. So these are the golden £5 pair of headphones. Let's continue.
it's funny. Some podcasters have such a, they're like audiophiles. They've got to have the right shock mounts and the stands and everything. You've just rocked up with a pair of headphones, £5, and you're killing it, mate. So don't worry about it. Well done.
Oh, thank you. Thank God.
So you're in the UK, which is good for me because we don't have to schedule out dodgy time zones and things. So it's nearly 12 o'clock here in the UK, which is great. But whereabouts are you? Tell us a little bit about where you are.
Absolutely. So audience, I'm in Fulham Broadway, London. I was up until a while back living in Italy, and we'll go on to talk about kind of why. But I'm based in Fulham, London, and enjoying the sunshine that we're having, not the World Cup, but everything as well.
Yeah, well, I'll skirt over the World Cup. It's still, I got a little bit of a pain in my heart there when you mentioned it, so we'll move along quickly on that one. So were you born like London way or?
Yeah, absolutely. So I was born, my family are from India. They came over in the 70s. I was born in a place called Uxbridge, which is near Heathrow Airport. And we as a family all moved over in the 70s. And I've still got a lot of my family working at the airport, actually. And then thankfully, here I am today.
Ah, well, that's really interesting. It's just pricked up my ears because I remember when you sent me an email, you've got a great website. We've just spoke offline about it. What is it? DeepakShukla.com, is it?
Exactly, exactly, wow. Exactly.
At least someone didn't pinch your name. don't get us started on that one, by the way.
Oh, God. I'm sorry.
And you know what it is? The guy who's sitting there, you go, I'm on it now. The guy who's sitting on Ian Farrer has never had a website. He's just sitting on the domain waiting for me to make him an offer.
Oh gosh, Jesus Christ, he knows you're somebody and this site doesn't even work. He's like, come on, the real Ian Farrer, come to Papa. You see he's got his fishing line, he's like reeling you in slowly. At some point you're gonna bite.
I'll prize out of his cold dead hands.
Yeah, you'll be like, F-U-C-K it, I'm gonna get it.
So anyway, your website was really good. I mean, I've just spoke offline about you because your website was great. It said a lot about you, the human, the real Deepak, which is great. So rather than the business side, you talk a lot about who you were as a person, your values and everything. And I wouldn't mind you just giving us 5 minutes on you because I would literally do you a disservice. You've seemed to have crammed so much into your short life already. So let's hear it.
Yeah, thank you, first of all, for the site. It was a labor of love. And very briefly, everybody, I'm about to turn 32, and the agency, the SEO agency, I started when I just turned 30. So it's been 18 months into it. And really simply put, I spent ultimately a lot of my 20s to express the cliche, discovering myself. What I kind of soon figured out was, right, I can basically earn £2,000 to £3,000 whilst I kind of do other stuff. And at that time, I was running, for example, a tutoring agency called Gobsmackers. And then I worked as something called the CV Guy. And what that really allowed me to do was give me time to just do stuff, dude. So that is the stuff that you refer to directly when you use the word cram. Absolutely. So I spent a lot of my 20s kind of traveling, running like endurance sport. I kind of got into marathons, and that went into ultras. I just did an Ironman this Sunday just gone. And I centered basically a lot of my 20s around kind of endurance sports. I say it like I'm good. I'm not. I'm really a pretty crappy all of those things, but I did it for the enjoyment of it. And at the point of 30, after I did an unsuccessful application to our SAS, qualified as a basically trained British soldier, I kind of then had my moment of breakdown being in Amsterdam at 30. And I thought, Jesus Christ, I need to perhaps build something that's going to lead me to at least a more initially financially secure future, doing something I enjoy, but still being able to, you know, as I said, do some of these sports like the Ironman on Sunday. And my business is something that I'm passionate about, but my life is something that I'm equally passionate about. And thankfully enough, it sounds like the site has done some job of communicating that.
Yeah, definitely. But it's interesting as you were talking there. For me, it's, you know, work-life balance is pretty hard now. So how are you coping with that then? Because you do quite a lot of stuff.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think that one thing that served me really well is continual. It's something they talk about in kind of the Navy SEALs, and it was made reference to when we did the training with our boys here, which is continual and prolonged exposure to kind of uncomfortable environments. And what that has really done for me has been quite useful in increasing my kind of tolerance for kind of commitments, let's call it. So juggling many things. So what has happened probably today that I wasn't as successful at, for example, 5 years ago, is that I've often found that it's not the actual act of doing things that inhibits us as people, but it's the psychology attached to doing the thing. So the example practically, if that sounds like a lot of esoteric BS, is that I had, for example, like the Ironman on Sunday. And it's like, right, you have a training plan, you commit to some part of the training plan, and then you turn up and do the day. It's a 12-hour day, it's a 15-hour day. And people can kind of psych themselves out and worry a lot more than you necessarily need to. And continual exposure to kind of uncomfortable things has allowed me, really, to be honest with you, to worry a lot less, perhaps, about some of the things that I do. And worrying less has actually set me free. So that's what has helped me. So that then allows me to kind of, you know, I've got another event coming up on the 29th, and I'm probably going to worry about it on the morning of the 28th. And up until then, I'll be busy doing other things, because that's been the part that set me free. I don't know if that makes any sense, but that's what I found to be actually the most helpful in a way that might be useful to the people listening, or not.
No, it totally does, and I can really resonate with that. I mean, but I guess it comes to experience. You know, you've experienced those harsh climates or environments or whatever psychological kind of stresses and strains on you, and now you've learned from that. I was just putting that down in my mind there, just a business, you know, like, so if I've worked overseas, for instance,
yeah,
traveled overseas on my own to a business meeting,
yeah,
with a room full of rock stars and a really important sales meeting, and I'm like, wow. And then,
oh shit,
yeah. And then, you know, like, now I could literally go on a plane now and do that, wouldn't be fazed by it, because it's experience.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes, yeah, you've got to have that experience. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day about the 22-year-old life coach scenario. It's you just kind of do it. You just need those battle scars, and, you know, and you need absolutely a few grey hairs to be able to do it. Even though you're only a boy at 32, you've got any grey hair on there yet.
I've got some greys, but that's why I keep it trim, I'll tell you that much. But now I'm balding at the top. I'm again something beginning with F and ending with D. So I'm like, Jesus Christ, Deeps. There's no avoiding the bald, the patches that are beginning to develop.
Just wear a hat. That's what I do, man. So
good man.
So what I want you to tell us some stuff today, because offline we were talking about the GDPR word and it's bloody awful. I even had a podcast on Brexit a few weeks ago, and the viewing figures went so low, the listening figures, because like nobody wants to hear about Brexit. But actually, we'll try and sneak in a bit GDPR here off the back of pretending that it's not about that. It's actually about sales and that kind of thing. Would that
work? Absolutely. Yeah, no, absolutely. Look, I'll directly address the kind of GDPR question. Guys, like, you know what? So number one, I'd say that GDPR is aimed at people that spam. Now, let me define what spam is, and it's really a common sense approach. Sending someone a completely irrelevant message, for example, being on this podcast and using the wrong podcast name and using the wrong interviewer's name would be an example of spam, something that's clearly been mistargeted or has nothing to do with, you know, what that person does in business. That's an example of spam. Now, ordinarily, you shouldn't be doing that regardless of GDPR, but that's really what GDPR is aimed at. That's number one. So don't spam people, right? Don't spam people. And as a general rule of thumb, you know, be nice, be respectful in any area of business. And this relates to everything outside of cold email. And you can do a lot without running ever into any issues, because there's no reason if you send someone a nice email, why would they report you? Now, in the instance that you disbelieve that and you think, well, no, Deepak, that's not what the rules and regulations said, then I would say that actually you're never going to get an immediate, in a worst case scenario event, you send 1,000 people the wrong message, you're going to get unsubscribed. You're going to get people that are going to perhaps say, hey, I'm really unhappy. But for you to actually get to the extent that you're going to get a fine, what people have failed to do is look enough at the legislation involving the actual process of being fined or getting a slap. It's like a 3 to 6 month process where you initially get a almost, if you like, a cease and desist letter, meaning that you get told, hey, we're not sure that you're doing this the right way. And then you get a chance to clean up house. So in a worst case scenario event, that will happen. So with those two things in mind, the reality is that you can send relevant targeted emails to others in business. And by and large, and when I say by and large, I'm talking statistically 99% of the time. If that's what you're doing, then you can continue business as usual, because there's no way in the world that, you know, you cannot send a message to somebody that you don't formally know, because that would strike a dagger through the heart of business just in general. So my perspective and my experience of it post GDPR has actually been the same as pre, meaning that, guys, if you're listening and you're worried, it's again that thing we just spoke about. Go and start sending some emails, and when you don't start getting some fines, you will start realizing that actually, wow, most of this was all in my head, and I can continue kind of as is sending relevant quality targeted emails. And that's really what should always be the focus of any level of communication that you have with someone that you don't know anyway.
Yeah, no, that sounds great. And listen, everybody, Deepak says it, so go and do it. Anything, any fines come back, just push it to him.
Absolutely. I will wrap up shop, move to wrap up. You'll find me in Gibraltar, PO box, and off and away.
Do I need to see anything legally about this?
You're like, Deepak, my lawyer's doing a company lookup and a personal lookup of you right now.
So think about that cold email then. How are you getting the addresses?
Yeah, absolutely. So, let's get into some of the mechanics of it. So if you are, for example, let's take an example that's probably practical in this case. So I had a client who runs an app development company. They develop iOS apps. And what he wanted to do is obviously generate business. So one of the easiest ways in this instance to initially, one, of course, you profile the kind of company that he'd want to do business with. And this was the kicker. You can often find a lot of these people anyway, because they're posting jobs on job boards. So someone who needs an iOS app developed at some stage of their journey may put a job advert out on angel.co, on LinkedIn Jobs, on Indeed, on basically any platform. If you can pick a particular platform, for example, let's just say Angel, where there are lots of businesses looking for iOS developers, then the real simple thing that you can do that's very targeted, that's very relevant, scales really well, that will likely generate you phone calls or email conversations and responses is by finding Fiona at, you know, myhealthcare.com, who is the HR manager as listed on Angel, that's just put an ad up saying, look, we're looking for app developers in general to build, you know, the Android version of our iOS app. And then finding her email is going to be pretty easy. And then you can do that via LinkedIn. There's tools called Scrap, skrapp.io. That's skrapp.io, or Hunter, which doesn't work for LinkedIn, but it does work for websites. And also the third element, of course, is that, you know, Fiona may well have put her email on Angel anyway, because she's seeking applicants. And you can find that type of person, basically, you can find 100 of those people. And that's the fastest, easiest way from a cold email perspective to actually start generating phone calls. And it's how, to be honest with you, in the beginning, Ian, I began to generate clients because I looked for people that were already posting SEO jobs on job boards across the internet, and I began to run cold email campaigns to them.
Oh, really interesting. So I've used it's Hunter.io, isn't it? So yeah. You've got to pay for these? Is the pricing?
No. So everything I've just mentioned, guys, is free. Basically, Hunter.io lets you search up to like 150 a month, perhaps, or something to that effect. Then Scrap.io. I mean, put it this way. Here's the thing. I will load this all up to the extent, and this is probably the part that people, I think, get wrong. And I did this, by the way, guys. So I initially started scraping a bunch of emails. I'd hire, you know, one of my many Indian friends from India to be like, hey man, can you scrape this LinkedIn Sales Navigator search? The problem with that is that you can't really personalize emails when you scale it in that fashion, because it's just too cumbersome. However, if you're only doing, like, for example, 10 cold emails per day to 10 types of Fiona, then it's going to be quite easy for you to personalize those. And you're still running 50 emails a week to people that you don't know. And given it's quite personalized, because they have got a job out on Angel, you can make reference to that. You can say, oh, Fiona, I looked you up on LinkedIn and noticed that you're the business development manager at healthcaresystems.com. So you will never fall foul of the actual free credits that Scrap and Hunter give you if you follow the process that I've just described.
Yeah, super cool. I love that.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, sorry, please continue. You were going to say
something. No. What I was just thinking of is, so from a LinkedIn point of view, then, is this something that you guys do from a marketing point of view? Is this what you coach? Do you that for them?
Yeah, absolutely. So this process that I've just described, to be honest with you, isn't what I, as you said, and it's how you introduced me is correct. So we're an SEO agency, and I am just in the middle of doing a course launch for building a lead generation agency, because I did. So I offered lead generation basically. So, our business is 18 months old. 3 months into our business, I began offering lead generation as a service, because lead generation, using, that's one of several processes that all involve cold outreach that I use to build my SEO agency. Because in the beginning, when I needed to keep my lights on, and I was still like at my mum's house, literally, after I'd come back from Amsterdam and I'd had this failed application, I was like, mum, I've bloody run out of money. I'm 30. I'm depressed. She's like, come home, son. Let's eat dal. Let's eat rice. Let's enjoy. And I was like, okay, I do like your dal. I do like your rice, but I need to move out. So I had to, I hired a couple of lead generation agencies myself, one freelancers. Then I moved to agency, and I kind of just had bad experience after bad experience. And I think it relates to just what you said, that, you know, one of the reasons that, and I didn't do it soon enough. I wish I'd done it sooner. One of the reasons I built deepakshukla.com is that, guys, there's humans behind these emails that you're sending people to. You know, Fiona in the, you know, Fiona is a human. She has her thoughts and feelings. And the more you can personalize and make it feel like genuine outreach, the better. So that's why the easiest, lowest hanging fruit when it comes to cold email is looking at job boards that cover the roles that you can offer as an outsourced service. So this really works well for anyone who offers services. If you can find a job description for it and you can find the root company, because the general objection might be, well, on Indeed is filled with recruiters, Deepak. And I'd say, well, of course there are, but there's actually 1,000 job listings for your role, typically on LinkedIn or whatever platform it might be. And there's going to be at least 30% of them, i.e. 300 in that instance, that are going to be company direct. And there's no reason you can't email all 300 of them, and that can generate the requisite phone calls, provided you can also, when you're only doing the 10 per day, make sure that you take a strap line from the actual company and use it as part of your mail merges. So one of the strap lines on my website, guys, if you wanted to cold email me, is, for example, life, love, and entrepreneurship. That's what's emblazoned upon my logo. So if you were to email me and say, hey, Deepak, I noticed that you're in the SEO space and I'd love to help you with lead generation, especially as I love your insert mail merge ethos of life, love, and entrepreneurship. I really think that that resonates with me. Would love to jump on a call with you. I would respond to that email because I would know no better and assume that they've personally looked up my website. And you probably have if you're only doing 10 per day. And the problem I think that I find with cold email is that people just look at the number. They're like, right, I need to email 300 people a month. And then it's kind of the spray and pray approach. And depending upon your deal sizes, if you're offering a £50 per month service, let's say broadly, then you're going to need volume. But if you're offering a premium service, you don't need volume, you need quality. Because if it's three or four businesses that can turn around your revenue, then it really just does make sense to focus on, don't email more than 10 people a day, build a system for it, screencast that system that I've just described, because that's what I did. Once I figured out all of the kinks and the quirks after a week of doing it, I screencasted all of the innumerable variations whereby, well, that mail merge might not fit because it doesn't quite make sense. Okay, look at something else on the website that will fit that issue. Then you can give it to a project manager or a virtual assistant or somebody else. And in that way, you're able to scale and then begin looking at more and more job boards. So at the moment, as we speak, I think I use mail merges to run outreach on Craigslist, work in startups, Angel, and that will generate, you know, 30% of kind of the new business that I'll do, because it just works, because everything I said actually is common sense. If someone's hiring for an SEO role and they get a cold email from someone who says, hey, I noticed you're hiring for an SEO role, Ian, I checked you out on LinkedIn, I know that you're the business coach at, you know, Industry Angels, then you would just tend to respond to that. And that's kind of the approach that I follow for cold email that I found invariably seems to work more often than not.
That's excellent. Thinking about the SEO side though, Deepak, I mean, we spoke offline and what you were saying was you needed to fill your pipeline quite quickly. So that's kind of why you started looking at that. But from the SEO point of view, it's more of a slower burn or a longer burn. Could you tell us a little bit about that? Because obviously that's your bread and butter now from an agency point of view.
Yeah. Absolutely. To make sure I give your listeners the most value, should I talk about it from things that people could do from an SEO perspective or the sales approach behind it or both?
All of the above. Sounds good. Well done.
Okay, brilliant. Yeah. I don't want to start talking about technical SEO and they're like, oh my God, I'm so bored. Brilliant. Okay. So number one, since we're talking about kind of outreach, let's briefly go into kind of the sales element of it. So, SEO is a service ultimately that you pay for a result in at least 3 months from now. The reality is then is that when you're looking at businesses that, you know, want or could work, need SEO, you need to make sure they have got one, a level of maturity in the game, or two, they've got the cash flow if they're still new to support SEO. Now that impacts your sales because one, it defines the kind of business that you need to approach. Invariably, guys, if you're gonna build an SEO agency, I wouldn't suggest really looking, for example, at companies that are small or startup. Now, I did mention Angel and it is a startup platform, but one of the filters that I'd look at is only looking at companies that have some level of funding, because then I know they've got money behind them. That's the first thing that I would say. So if you're doing LinkedIn lookups or company lookups, be sure that you profile properly. The second thing outside of that is SEO is a weird space that it's, and this really relates to wider business, that, you know, it's still H2H, it's human to human, meaning that broadly speaking, when you're comparing, for example, the big four in accountancy, you know, PwC, Deloitte, Accenture, KPMG, that they all ultimately, if you look at it logically or objectively, sell very, very, very similar services. So it's going to be the personal touches that you can bring to it. So what was important for me when I started to get into kind of some of these calls and conversations was that I made sure to that I looked very human online and that I had a lot of social proof. So also the other part of it might be when people are doing outreach, make sure you have strong personal social signals. So what I mean by that, guys, is make sure that you've made the effort to really optimize your LinkedIn, that you look friendly, look human, and that you have interests that relate to nothing about your business space, because that's really the unique thing I think you can bring to a conversation. Anyone can do SEO, but I may be the only SEO guy that, you know, runs marathons, for example, or at least talks about running marathons. And that could sometimes be the differentiating factor that gets you in the door. Now, let's talk about the actual implementation of it and some simple things that people could take away, perhaps. The real simplest way to start, guys, is whatever stage of kind of your business you're at, let's call it the competition curve. Whatever stage you're at, I'd say look at businesses that dominate your industry, and also look at startups that are rising fast. And what I literally did in the beginning, and this has great SEO value, is I would look up, for example, if I'm a healthcare provider and there's Fiona's Healthcare Systems, it's one of my competitors, I would Google Fiona's Healthcare Systems. I would do a front-end lookup, meaning I'd literally have a look at every platform that Fiona's Healthcare Systems has listed on. So if there's like health directories, if there's health consultancy platforms, and then I would make a list of all of those platforms I find their business on. I would then do that for two or three other businesses in the space, and I'd develop a pretty comprehensive list of platforms that they seem to be listed on. I then immediately went out and did the same thing. So that's one of the quick things that you can do. So if you're a graphic designer and you're not listed on Behance, you're not listed on Star Now, you're not listed on Dribbble, you're not listed on Silk Dot, whatever it might be, you're not listed on Visually or Infographic LY or whatever these platforms are, then you should be. And a lot of the time, a lot of people kind of don't take care of house, meaning that you aren't listed on half of the platforms your competitors are. And this is something that a lot of people, for whatever reason, including myself, you know, don't really do. So one of the things you'll notice if you guys look up Pearl Lemon, we're like the only, well, we're not, but we're like one of very few agencies when you just, you know, I've got, you know, we've got 44 reviews on Trustpilot. A lot of agencies aren't even on Trustpilot, but some of them were, the best ones were, and I decided to copy those guys. What that meant is that I've generated business directly from Trustpilot when some businesses have looked out for me, but then also it helps trust factors, it helps domain reputation, it helps your branded network. So I'm going to stop talking now because I've been talking for a long time, but I hope that that's of some help to everyone.
Yeah, you don't need to stop talking because that's all really good and you're giving us some great value there. So that's amazing. But that's obviously, we're talking directories there. So get yourself on directories. I want no more, mate. Yeah. You're going to have to keep talking.
Okay, absolutely. Absolutely. So guys, so number one is, of course, directories, right? Number two is platforms for reputation management. So when I say reputation management, literally, do make sure that you've got Facebook reviews. You've got Facebook reviews, you've got Yelp reviews, you've got Trustpilot reviews, that you've got people that are contract. So for example, you might say, Deepak, I'm a one-man band. If you give anyone any advice ever, even for 20 minutes, ask that person for a review. So this is really helpful for local SEO because a lot of it, you know, when we think about, for example, the App Store optimization, or we think about Google Maps, like the 3-pack optimization, ratings are one of the biggest drivers of really like results at a local level. That actually still applies across the board. So do make sure that you make have a good crack at getting reviews. Again, you know, we've got like 58 Google reviews. SEO agencies, for whatever reason, don't have that, right? I don't know why they don't have that. But what that has meant is that only 2 months ago, I finally decided to be like, you know what, we should really start SEOing our site. So we're trying to rank, for example, for SEO Agency London, which is a hugely competitive keyword, but we broke out at, you know, position 55 within 2 weeks of deciding that we want to rank for that keyword. And now that's meaningful, because we shouldn't ordinarily do that. But a lot of that is in part because we've got strong reputational management factors. So the second part is reputational management. And now let's keep going, because you're going to say Deepak, I want more.
Yeah, so right. We've got directory, we've got reviews, loving it. Keep going.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. So, what I'm focusing on here, guys, is, and there's a specific reason I'm being, let's call it like non-technical. I want you guys to be able to actually, I want it to be things that you can really do yourself and you immediately understand and that you have a comprehension of. So the third thing to say is that if you guys ever give advice about your industry, or you do mentorship, or about anything of the ilk that relates to, one, how to grow in your industry, or two, about the service that you provide. So if you're a consultancy, you'll do two. If you're an accounting consultant, let's say, you'll do two things. You'll tell people how to build an accounting consultancy, and two, you'll give accounting advice to your clients. Why aren't you documenting that, right? So content is the biggest thing or stumbling block that people have. So screencast. So record all of the content that you give or that you deliver to others. If it's Skype, record the Skype call. If you don't know how to record the Skype call, figure it out. Once you've got the content in video form, because I know that none of you can be bloody bothered to write content, completely fine, totally understood, then you've got the content to put onto YouTube. You can go to fiverr.com. You can, you know, go to the word transcription, search it, look for level 2 rated sellers, and you can, with enough copy pasting the pitch that you want, haggle your way to 60 minutes worth of word for word verbatim transcriptions for like 20 quid. That's 60 minutes worth of audio, right? Which is a couple of thousand words. So you're ultimately spending 100 quid a month if you want to, and you can get like 10,000, I don't know, 5,000 words of content that's verbatim. And that is great for leverage from an SEO perspective. Number one, once you've got that content, you can obviously put up your video on YouTube on your website, which again helps you rank faster with your transcription, which again helps content and keeping it fresh. And again, you can use that transcription to submit as the closed captions on YouTube if you've already put the video on YouTube. And again, you can add it to the YouTube actual description. And again, if you hire an SEO agency like myself, I'll be like, Jesus Christ, you've given me some content to work with. So now I can optimize it with Yoast SEO, whatever it may be. But if you build a workflow around that, again, over time, that's going to be a significant competitive advantage. It solves your content problem, that solves a lot of SEO problems that more often than not, a lot of your competition won't do.
So thinking about that transcription, where would you put it on the site? Would it be a blog article, but it would be a lengthy one? Is it just a matter of getting it on there? You don't want it to be found?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So I would put that, first of all, on the YouTube closed captions if you're going to be uploading the video. If you're not going to be uploading the video, then you can, it really depends. Okay, so this is the part. You can, if you want to, of course, just verbatim put it in and write at the top saying, hey, if anyone's interested, here's a transcription. Or you could have, for example, an editor to go in and kind of clean some parts of it up. If you have, if you have a blog that people tend to genuinely actually read, then of course you need to make it as nice as possible. If you have a blog that you think really is never going to be read anyway, then you can, if I'm being honest, afford to be a bit more lenient. Of course, more is more in terms of more customization is more, but if it's something that means that you're time poor and you want the system, then it's better to just copy paste that transcription up and put it onto your site than not to do anything with it at all or to worry about it, because it, you know, as long as you're talking about good stuff like we are now, then you will probably be using some of the keywords that are relevant to your site. You can add kind of internal links to those keywords, and it will still be, you know, 1,000 words worth of content on your subject, and people will probably skip reading the actual script if they like what they think you have to say, and maybe start watching the video or vice versa. So it should capture potentially both kinds of people, if that makes sense.
No, it definitely does. And then if they don't, they might just look at other pages on the website.
Yeah, Exactly. I'm hoping that you're not going to be like, I want more, but if you want more, I can answer, dude.
you're hoping I'm not going to do that. Oh, really?
Okay. Dude, you do whatever you want. What did I say, Deepak? What did you say, Jesus Christ?
So what we've done is we've talked about directories there. We've talked about reviews. We've talked about content. I want to ask you about social media. How does that input?
Absolutely. And so this... Okay, so this social media becomes important depending upon the competition curve. This is the kind of phrase that I keep coming back to. So really simply, guys, depending upon where you are on the competition curve, meaning the competition curve refers to, you know, how far close to page one are you, number one, and then also two, how competitive is your industry? Okay, this is where, you know, social can or cannot be important. So if you're, for example, a plumber, then you could have a industry that's got a generally speaking low competition curve, meaning that a lot of your competitors ultimately aren't doing SEO. Therefore, social signals really are of less importance from the SEO perspective because your competition aren't really doing that much. So you could potentially have minimal to no content apart from some strong service pages, great directory listings on a local basis. You've made a real good effort to get a load of reviews from genuinely happy customers, and that can of itself be enough. Now, it might not be if you get to page one, rank number seven, because whilst your industry has a low competition curve, you might be high up the competition in terms of the people that are competing. If you are at that stage, then social media definitely does have a bearing. If you're in an alternative industry such as fashion, let's say, where there's clearly a huge visual element of it, then I'm not even going to bother approaching that because of course you're going to do social media because it's bread and butter for your business. But if you're in a business that's somewhere else in the middle, like you do, I don't know, you wholesale mangoes or something and you're working with other manufacturers that wholesale sell mangoes, then social signals really depends upon the complexity of your competition. Broadly speaking, you know, Google Plus, Google likes, YouTube, Google likes, and that's why, you know, YouTube certainly is one that I would make big use of generally because it does help with that social signal thing. And then also if you have assets like videos or podcasts like this, using the power of syndication, you can still go some way in increasing the level of social signals.
I like the fact that, you know, Google loves Google. I get that. What about things like LinkedIn though and Facebook and Twitter? What is there any correlation with SEO with those?
I think that I wouldn't say so much. I mean, there is, but okay, put it this way. There is, but it's comparable to a marathon runner worrying about the gel pack that they need to take mile 18 when they haven't even been training for the last 2 weeks. And I'd be like, dude, you're worrying about the wrong darn thing.
No bother.
Like so yes and no, and you probably can anticipate the yeses and the noes there.
Yeah.
That becomes important once you've got to that 18 miler, then absolutely we can talk about it all day long. But if you haven't got the mechanics, don't even worry about it, guys.
Excellent stuff. So do you think the priority then is not so much putting stuff out on social media if you haven't got an audience and if you mightn't get found? It's more so put the content on your website and get found that way?
Absolutely. If we're talking a Google rank, right, specifically like, well, a search engine rank, let's say, then make sure that your infrastructure, which is your basically your house, which is your website, make sure that your shopfront is in order. And that, you know, and that's where you can get a bit technical. You've got your sitemaps, you've got different types of sitemaps, robots, text to, you know, see which pages Google can access and which they can't. You've got sitemaps to understand, you know, how do I navigate your website? You've got, you know, if you're looking at mobile first sites and all of this kind of stuff, I would say make sure that that is really in order because that will help you then, you know, with the content, with your directories, with your local listings for the directories as well as reputation management. And of itself, depending upon the competition curve of your industry plus your competitors, that will go a long way, definitely.
It's really interesting, you know, people who work in different sectors or have different businesses at different levels, this might resonate with them. I was speaking to someone recently who just had no website because Facebook was their revenue, their lead generation. You know, other people I know really boss it on LinkedIn. That's how they get theirs. But what we're saying here is if you have got a website, and if you are wanting to be found on Google, these are some of the things we need to do.
Absolutely. And this is that conversation that comes in that, you know, if you've already got a system that works, right, of course, there's, you know, commercially and your common sense tells you that, well, let me keep working on the systems that works. And I would say to that, that you absolutely should. But if you aren't diversifying your sources of income, you will be screwed when there comes a day that that platform stops working for you. And that's what I would say that the consideration comes in, meaning that if 80% of your revenue is Deepak, I drive all my sales from LinkedIn, I'd be like, brilliant. Well, use some of that additional capital to then invest in building a second revenue stream, because you can afford to, can't you? Because one day LinkedIn might block you, or one day you might find that your audience has shifted platform, or one day you know, let's think about the one day, which is also why, depending upon the kind of business you are and where you're at in your business, SEO isn't, you know, perhaps a day one kind of a day one thing that you need to attack if you're looking for kind of the result tomorrow.
Yeah, excellent. I guess what we're saying there is, don't put all the eggs in one basket, or don't build a house on someone else's land. Yeah.
I should have just asked you to summarize it for me. Mate. That was much probably better. No, cool. Jesus, I was like,
I love it. Sure it is. We're gonna have to wrap this up because we've been waffling for too long. But there's gonna have to be a volume two in here, I think.
Oh, dude, this has been a lot of fun, and thank you for putting up with my waffling, Ian. You ask good questions, and I thought, let me answer. Your summaries are far better, guys. The motto is, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Thank you. Goodbye.
So listen, before you go, tell people where they can find you. I've already done it, but you do it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So guys, Deepak, D-E-E-P-A-K, and then Shukla, both spelled phonetically, like as you'd say it, S-H-U-K-L-A. Guys, just kind of Google me, LinkedIn me, YouTube me. You'll find a load of stuff on YouTube. You'll find my website. You know, if you want to hire me for SEO, great. If you don't and you just want to have a chat, also great. I'm pretty easygoing, and thank you, Ian, for having me on Industry Angel. It's been a pleasure, mate.
No worries. And if you do Google Deepak and you can't find him, let me know so I can kick his ass.
that will be just prior to my Gibraltar move. So thank you, Ian. Goodbye.
Cheers, Deepak. See you soon, man.
Thank you, buddy.
Thanks to Deepak there. What a super genuine guy. I hope you enjoyed that one. Lots of value for you there, especially around the cold email and finding addresses. I'll make sure I'll drop the links in the show notes of the sites that Deepak mentioned. Also, there was good food for thought around the SEO side of your website in terms of directories, reviews, and content. I've actually got a good blog article on my website, far-north.com, about sending the Google review link to your contacts. So when they click the link, it brings up the review box pre-populated with 5 stars. Nice cheeky little hack. I'll link that up as well. So yeah, great value there. And we'll have to get Deepak back on the show, yeah? So until next time, I'm Ian Farrer. This is the Industry Angel, and thanks for listening.